everything, peer review thing, like I said. And the deadlines for the peer reviews are, I think we set them to be in line with the next homework. They're supposed to be very straightforward. There's like 5 questions you answer. You'll be each assigned like 2 or 3 other projects to review. So when you turn in homework 4 that same day, you have to submit your reviews. Any questions about that stuff? That's a good point. That was a question too, and the answer is yes, I can use the microphone. Okay, any other questions? Okay, so today we're gonna finish off our discussion of high dimensional regression. We're gonna prove a bunch of results, or at least state a bunch of results and prove some results for the lasso. Then I have, as usual, I've made the notes to be way too long, but I kind of do that on purpose so that you can read up on extra stuff if you're curious. So we're not gonna get to everything in the notes, but there's a section 5 that I added before today, so that's new. I added a couple days ago on the notes, and this is a bunch of, let's say, like variants of extensions of competitors to the lasso. And we, I guess after we do some of the theory, which is kind of more fundamental, we can either go through some of these, pick and choose, you guys can tell me what you want to hear about, and or I can show some simulations that compare subset selection to the lasso, which is what I mentioned a couple times ago. So after the break, I'll just see what people are interested in. So let's just recall this result that we proved last time, at the very end of class. We kind of squeezed it in right at the end, which is if this is the lasso program, right, this convex optimization program, so we choose beta to minimize this criterion, which I'm also denoting by f, f of beta, just to be, I'm gonna refer to that a bit later, the least squares law subject to an L1 constraint. And if you told me you had an underlying linear model, right, where the errors were, let's say, normal with mean 0 and covariant sigma squared and x was fixed, then if I choose the penalty parameter to be the L1 norm of the underlying coefficients, so if I tune this optimally, right, that seems like the optimal tuning because this is just the level of complexity. If I take T to be the one norm of the coefficients in the population, it's just the right level of complexity and not too complex, then for any delta between 0 and 1, we get the following result. So for any delta between 0 and 1, we've proved that the n-sample risk, should say 1 over n, times the squared norm between x beta hat and x beta 0, is bounded by 4 times sigma times the square root of 2 log e p over delta. P is the number of variables here, so it's the number of columns of x. N is the number of observations, number of rows of x. This e is just the exponential number. This is e. So log of e is 1. And we just put this in here as a padding so that even when p is 1 and when delta is 1, this quantity isn't trivial, right? If we just had p over delta, then when p was 1 and delta was 1, this would be 0. So the bound would actually not be true. This e is just, we put that in there because now this holds for any p and for any delta. It's just for convenience. And I'll comment again where this term came from. It came from an inequality that bounded the maximum of Gaussians, which is actually straightforward to prove and is on your homework, homework 4. And this is the L1 norm of the underlying coefficients. Okay, so let's just pause and look at that bound for a second. We can see that if the L1 norm of the underlying coefficients grew more slowly than root log p over n, okay, so if the complexity as measured by the L1 norm of the underlying coefficients grew more slowly than root log p over n, like suppose it was little o of root log p over n, then this whole thing goes to 0 as n and p go to infinity, which makes the lasso consistent in a high dimensional scenario, right, where let's say n and p go to infinity, and we're interested in the n-sample risk. This was true with probability at least 1 minus delta. Okay. Also, if we think about, let's say, the underlying coefficients each having constant magnitude, let's say they have magnitude 1, just for simplicity, and there was S0 of them, then this thing is equal just to S0, right? The L1 norm of the coefficients is just the sum of their absolute values. And if they have each have value 1, there's S0 of them that are non-zero, then this is just S0. So this is now 4 times S0 root log P over N. And compare that to subset selection, which was 4 S0, or just like something on the order of S0 log P over N. Okay, so this is a whole lot slower, right, than what we got with subset selection under the same set of assumptions. So that's one thing to notice. And this is roughly the minimax rate. S0 log P over N is roughly the minimax rate, so subset selection was doing about as good as we could have hoped in a kind of generic situation like this. All right, one other comment, and you'll investigate this in your homework as well, but through a slightly different avenue, is what do you expect the expected in-sample risk to be? If I took an expectation, what would you expect it to be? On what order? So if instead of having a high probability bound, I was interested in this bound. What do you expect that to be in terms of order? So if I say this is, you know, big O of something, that's my notation for it scales at a particular rate. It's not a trick question. It's just supposed to be, sorry? Well, no, P over N would be for regression, right? We're still doing the lasso. So we know this is true with high probability. So how about an expectation? It's just the same, right? I would expect this is to be, again, something like this. Right, if I drop, if I think of sigma as a constant, then this is what it would be. It's the same order. And in fact, you already know this is true from what you know about the relationship between OP bounds and expectation bounds. On homework one, I think I wrote a question in there that said that suppose you knew that you had a probability bound that held with an exponential tail. That's what this is saying. Okay, that essentially, written in this form, the probability with which this fails, it appears inside of a log. So if we were to reparameterize, we would say something like this is less than or equal to a constant times root log P over N with probability 1 minus exponentially small in that constant. Okay, just reparameterize. You write this delta as inside the log as, let's say, a constant multiplying this whole thing. So we have a probability bound that holds with exponentially high probability in the constant. That actually implies an expectation bound. That was on your first homework. If you forget that, go back and look at that. That was like maybe one of the first questions on homework one. Okay, so through that argument, you could also convince yourself this was true. The same rate would hold an expectation. Now, in general, of course, we know that a bound in probability does not apply a bound in expectation. Right? That's just not true in general. But if it holds somehow with this exponentially decaying tail, like the probability of failure occurs in a log term, for example, when we're writing it like this, then it doesn't imply a bound in expectation. Okay, so I'm making that clear just because subset selection was actually stated in terms of the expected in sample risk, the result for that. Okay, so let me very quickly run through the proof of that once more, because the proofs of almost all the lasso results, and really almost all the results in high dimensional regression, proceed in this way. So once you learn this trick, you'll start thinking that a lot of papers that you see in, you know, various technical avenues that prove stuff on the lasso or related estimators aren't really that kind of, you know, let's say mysterious or magical anymore. So we always start off with the same observation, which is that just due to the fact that we optimized f, okay, the loss at f at beta hat, so f of beta hat, because this was chose to minimize f, is less than or equal to the loss at beta 0. Now, that's also true because we chose t so that beta 0 was feasible for that program, right? Beta 0 is a feasible point in that optimization problem. If we chose t to be too small, right, if t was smaller than the L1 norm of beta 0, this would no longer be true necessarily, because beta 0 might not be feasible for that. Okay, but this is true. And then we just basically rearrange to make this statement. This is how the proof proceeded. And then we did something else here, which is that in a different language than what I presented to you last time, we looked at a Taylor expansion, a second order Taylor expansion of this thing around beta 0. Okay, so I said that let's do a second order Taylor expansion. F of beta hat is approximately equal to, we'll make this more precise in a second, F of beta 0 plus what goes here, it's the gradient of F at beta 0 transpose beta hat minus beta 0, right, plus 1 half beta hat minus beta 0 transpose the Hessian at beta 0 of beta hat minus beta 0. So this is just a second order Taylor expansion, right? And what are these terms? Let's just fill in these terms. This we're going to leave here because we're going to subtract it over, and we're going to try to get a lower bound on this difference. So let's write it like this. Again, this is a second order Taylor expansion, approximately so far. Let's first ask ourselves, what is this? If the loss is that one, what's the Hessian? I'm sure you guys know this. First of all, it doesn't depend on beta 0. I will close my eyes, so if you get the answer wrong, don't worry, I won't even know who said it. Somebody shout anything out. It can be anything at all. All right, X transpose X, that's right. Okay, that's the Hessian matrix. If that was, that's not clear to you, then make sure to review, you know, your multivariable calculus. X transpose X. So what is this term? This whole term then is just, you know, 1 half X beta hat minus X beta 0. I have just rearranged. We have beta hat minus beta 0 transpose x times beta hat minus beta 0. That's exactly what we want to bound, right? So that's good. That's very good. OK. Now, what is this thing? The gradient at beta 0. Somebody can yell out what they think it is. No, it's not 0, but let's just get the form of it down without computing it yet. OK, so the gradient of the loss function at an arbitrary parameter beta is this guy. That's, in fact, the negative gradient. So the gradient is, yeah, this is the gradient. See? So at beta 0, it's this. OK, and what is this? That's just epsilon. So this whole thing is just minus x transpose epsilon transpose beta hat minus beta 0. OK, that should also look familiar from last time. So what we've said is the difference between the criterion at beta hat and the criterion at beta 0 is approximately equal to minus x transpose epsilon times beta hat minus beta 0 plus this. OK? But we actually know even more in this case. This is actually an equality for the least squares loss. Somebody tell me why that's true. Why is that an equality for the least squares loss rather than just an approximation? F was a quadratic to begin with, so it should be equal to its second order Taylor expansion, right? There's no approximation. It really is just a quadratic. So if we take two terms in its Taylor expansion, then that's what it is. OK, the reason I wrote it like this, though, is to show you how this would work if F wasn't a quadratic. So suppose you wanted to analyze logistic regression. OK, then you would do something like what we just did here, but you wouldn't be able to conclude an equality. Those of you who took convex optimization, when can I make this a bigger than or equal to? Tell me when this is true. What properties of F make that true? Somebody who took optimization with me. What's the property of F that makes this true? It's strong convexity. If F is strongly convex, then it lies above its second order Taylor expansion, right? In fact, here we would put in M times I. That would be its, if it was M strongly convex. So this would be true for a strongly convex function with parameter M. So now you can also see why convexity of the optimization problem matters. So if we use the logistic loss, and in the neighborhood of the solution, we convinced ourselves it was strongly convex with parameter M, with some parameter M, then we would actually be able to lower bound this difference, which is still good enough for what we want. Okay, so I'll just make that, I'll write that here. You get bigger than or equal to when F is a strongly convex function with parameter M, and in that case, this thing is, we can write as M times the identity, where M is the strong convexity parameter. Okay, but just for our sake, we didn't need to do this because we actually had this being equal to its second order Taylor expansion, but this is how a proof for another type of loss function would proceed, for example. Okay, so put this together, what we've shown is that if we rearrange, right, we have minus this plus this is less than or equal to 0, because this is the difference in the criterion value, it's exactly equal to this. In other words, x beta hat minus x beta 0 squared is less than or equal to 2 times epsilon transpose x beta hat. I wanted to leave it like that, actually. X transpose epsilon transpose beta hat minus beta 0. Okay, that's where that's what we computed last time kind of directly, but this is another way of looking at it, which is fruitful because it shows you what you would do for kind of different loss functions. Okay, and this is sometimes called, this quantity is often called the Gaussian complexity or sub-Gaussian complexity. If we didn't assume that epsilon was Gaussian but sub-Gaussian, in fact, all the same results would have held for the lasso throughout what we're going to talk about today. But we're just assuming Gaussianity for simplicity. And this term is called the Gaussian complexity term. So it's something, we ask ourselves a question of the following form. If I had a Gaussian random variable, x transpose epsilon, right? And the components of this each have variance at most n sigma squared. Because, I guess I didn't write it down, but, one of the assumptions we made last time was that the columns of x all had norm at most n. Okay, that's the only assumption made about x. So the components of this have variance at most sigma squared n. And this is a Gaussian random variable. If I take its inner product with, let's say, a vector, call it delta, this vector is delta, how big can that be under some assumptions about the complexity of delta? Now, what we know about the complexity of delta, let's call this term, let's call delta beta hat minus beta 0. The only thing we know about this complexity term with respect to this program is that its L1 norm is at most 2 times t, just by the triangle inequality. Right, because each of them are feasible for that program. So remember, we're choosing t to be the L1 norm of the coefficients. So again, now we ask ourselves, if you gave me a vector with L1 norm at most 2t, and you took an inner product with a Gaussian vector, how big can that be? And if we can answer that question, then we know how to bound the in-sample risk. This is the way, like, essentially all proofs proceed with high-dimensional estimation, but there are like variants that we play in terms of how we exactly bound these things and how we set them up. Here, actually, the way to bound that is quite simple. We just use Holder's inequality. Right? So by Holder's inequality, we say that the inner product between x transpose epsilon and this guy delta is less than or equal to the infinity norm of x transpose epsilon times the 1 norm of delta. All right, so Holder's inequality allows us to bound any inner product by the product of their norms, of essentially dual norms. So this could be the P norm, this could be the Q norm, where P and Q are complementary. They have the property that 1 over P plus 1 over Q is 1. And here, because we know something about the L1 norm of delta, that's all we know, we're going to use this form of Holder's inequality, right? Because that's really the only useful thing to do. If we chose, say, the 2 norm here and the 2 norm here, then that wouldn't be a very good idea. OK, and this thing is less than or equal to 2 times the maximum absolute entry of x transpose epsilon times the 1 norm of the coefficients, underlying coefficients, just by this inequality here. So now it's up to us to compute this guy. So far, by the way, notice everything's been deterministic. This is a deterministic bound. There's nothing random here. Everything holds deterministically. This is where, and this is deterministic too. Holder's inequality always holds. There's nothing to do with high probability yet. This is what we're going to bound with high probability. Okay, and if we denote W to be X transpose epsilon, then let's say WJ for J going from 1 through P, this thing is normal with mean 0 and variance, let's call it sigma J squared. Okay, and what is sigma J squared? Well, sigma J squared is equal to sigma squared times the norm of xj squared, just by definition of w, and this is at most sigma squared n. So now we're trying to compute the maximum of an absolute value of p normals. And from your homework, you'll prove this is true, that if I look at the maximum of p normals, then this is less than or equal to an absolute value. This is less than or equal to the biggest variance among all of them, but the biggest variance is at most sigma squared times, the biggest standard deviation among all of them, which is sigma root n, times root 2 log ep over delta. This is true with probability at least 1 minus delta. Okay, and now all that's left to do is to plug in to get the result. Plug that into here. Divide by n, because we always think about the in-sample risk being 1 over n times this quantity, and we get the result, this result right here. Plug in and finish. Questions about that? OK, so that was just a review of the proof that we did last time. Now we're going to kind of whip through a bunch of other results, which are just kind of slight variants on that strategy. OK. So the next thing I have in the notes, I think, is what happens in terms of the predictive risk. OK, this one I'll just state in class. And you're going to prove it on the homework, actually. So that was the in-sample risk. You could ask, what about the out-of-sample risk? So basically, a fairly similar proof, a bit more involved, shows that the out-of-sample risk this guy, in terms of its rate, so here we saw that the in-sample risk was root log p over n times the 1 norm of beta naught. It's a little bit worse, which is not surprising again. given what we know about the in-sample and out-of-sample risks. So we can bound it by root log p over n times the L1 norm of beta naught squared. Now this places, you know, a stronger restriction on somehow how fast this can grow, right? We said if the L1 norm of beta naught in this case grew as little o of square root of log p over n, then we get consistency. Here it has to grow of as little o of log p over n to the 1/4 in order to get consistency. Okay, so it's a slightly worse result for the out-of-sample risk. And that one you'll prove in the homework. It's fairly similar to this, just with one extra step, basically. Okay, let me do actually the penalized form, and then we'll do something called the Oracle inequality and take maybe a break. Yeah, question first.
So getting these bounds requires setting t appropriately. So how sensitive are they to, since we don't actually know the L1 zero?
It's a good question. So the question is, what happens if we vary t? Well, I mean, the exact same analysis actually shows that this bound holds, right? Nothing changes if we set t to be larger than beta 0, the L1 norm of beta 0. We get this bound. Right, so as long as we kind of take it to be big enough, then that's the rate we can get. And I mean, I'm not really sure what else to say in regards to your question. So was your question, like, what happens if we choose it, like, randomly or something, like via cross-validation or something?
Well, what if we choose t smaller? Because we don't know that.
Yeah, so in terms of the one thing that's maybe slightly more advanced, but it may be a good point worth making, is that if you choose t to be too small in terms of the constrained form, that's pretty catastrophic, because then beta 0 is no longer even feasible for the program. So we can't say anything about the risk in that case. So erring on the side of choosing t to be too big is really what we have to do from a theoretical perspective. The penalized form is a bit more forgiving, in a sense, to the choice of penalty parameter. Those results are kind of a little bit more subtle. But if you're curious, then there's actually a paper in the notes Chatterjee. Shrav Chatterjee is the person who's worked on this kind of stuff. I could point you to a paper if you're interested. So even though I guess we think about the bound form, the penalized form, as being more or less equivalent, in terms of how we set the parameter, the bound form is somehow more sensitive to bad choices of the parameter, which is, it's a good question. Theoretically, as long as we take this to be large enough, then we still have a result. And how useful that result, I guess, depends on how loose this is, t compared to the actual L1 norm. Separate from this, I mean, you might ask what happens if we choose t, or in the penalized form, maybe lambda, via cross-validation. Because that's what we usually do in practice, right? We wouldn't somehow set it. We wouldn't have any idea how big this is, so we would probably use something like cross-validation. Theoretically, this is actually very complicated because cross-validation has a very analyzing cross-validation is very difficult because of the dependence between the folds, and the results are currently being developed, but they're much worse than if we knew somehow the right level of t like this. So that's also maybe important pointing out. But this is obviously, I think, a very important question to address theoretically, because this reflects how we do things in practice. Okay, good question. Any other questions? So let me run through penalized form, because really the answer or the strategy for analysis is really very similar, so we're going to not spend a ton of time going through it in detail because it'll basically match this. So now we'll write the lasso as this guy, and again we'll call this F. Okay, and we'll make the same assumptions as before, as we did with the constraint form, and we'll start off with, again, the observation that the criterion value at the minimizer, because beta hat shows the minimize that, is less than or equal to the criterion value at the underlying coefficients, and we'll subtract off F of beta 0 from both sides, and we'll move this, subtract off this from both sides. Okay. And we'll make the same observation that we did before, which is that this is equal to its second order Taylor approximation around beta 0, which is just this, minus x transpose epsilon transpose beta hat minus beta 0 plus this guy. So rearranging, right, rearranging from that same trick, we'll just write it like this. Okay, now notice that everything here is true no matter the choice of lambda. That was maybe one thing that I was trying to explain earlier, that if we didn't choose t appropriately, we couldn't even start with a statement. But this is a deterministic bound, and everything here is true no matter how we chose lambda. Right, so we at least have some traction in the penalized form with arriving at a conclusion that's valid kind of for any lambda. Now to get a result that's on this order, root log p over n, we're going to have to choose lambda appropriately, but I mean, you'll kind of see when we start making statements that involve a choice of lambda. So everything here is valid for any lambda. Okay, so now we do just basically what we did before, right, which is we use Holder's inequality to bound this term. We use the same form of the bound as before. All right, again, this thing is called the Gaussian complexity term. It's the inner product of a Gaussian vector with some vector that has some structure. All right, the structure that we think here is that each of these should have a small L1 norm again. So we'll use Holder's inequality to tell us that this is true. I guess I missed the 2 here. Not that this is that important, but just for complete list. Because we had this Taylor approximation involved this times a half. So I multiply it through by 2 to clear that half. Okay, and now we're going to say that this is less than or equal to, just as before, 2 sigma root n times log ep over delta times this guy. This is true with probability. At least 1 minus delta, same bound. And we want to arrive at a bound that looks like, in this scale, right, where we haven't divided by n, root n log p times the L1 norm of beta 0. Okay, but the tricky part here is that we don't actually have any control over how big the L1 norm of beta hat should be explicitly, because we didn't use a bound, right? It's just penalized form. But thankfully, we have a term that looks like minus the L1 norm of beta 1, the L1 norm of beta hat, excuse me, here. So if we choose lambda appropriately, then we can somehow balance the contribution of beta hat here with here, and that'll be our way of kind of controlling for its size. So in particular, let's use the triangle inequality. And just write this as beta hat plus beta naught, each one in the L1 norm. Okay? And remember that this is 2 lambda beta 0 minus beta hat 1. And now let's observe that if we happen to choose lambda large enough, if lambda is bigger and equal to this quantity, then we can say that this and this, right, will add up to something less than or equal to 0. If we choose lambda to be exactly equal to this quantity, then they'll add up to be 0. If we choose lambda bigger than this quantity, then they'll add up to be something negative. Okay, so this is less than or equal to, we get a 4 times lambda times beta 0 and the 1 norm, provided lambda is bigger than or equal to sigma root n log p, essentially, right, with the constants and stuff. So for any choice of lambda bigger than or equal to this guy, we get this bound, okay? And if we choose lambda to be equal to this, or a constant times this, then we get the same order bound that we got before, right? So in particular, let's say when lambda is equal to this, then we get that the in-sample risk is less than or equal to 4 sigma, same bound, log EP over delta divided by n. Okay, so just to reiterate one more time on Alan's question, which was a good observation, there's a difference in somehow where the choice of tuning parameter comes in here. Okay, so we still have a bound. This bound is still valid for any lambda, just that when we choose lambda large enough, we get somehow like the right rate. Whereas we couldn't even start our analysis, our theoretical analysis, in the bound form unless we chose t to be large enough. Okay, any questions about that one, penalized form? So this is, I'd say, the most common form in which people solve these problems, penalized form, and also analyze these problems. So the vast majority of papers that analyze high-dimensional estimators use something like this. And sometimes they're a bit smarter about how they bound this thing, this Gaussian complexity. Okay, sometimes we can be smarter about how we bound this thing. That maybe improves the rate. Sometimes we can be a bit smarter about sparsity, and we cannot just use a triangle inequality here, but use something a bit more clever. Those are maybe two ways in which we can improve these rates. Just as an editorial comment, if we went back to the non-parametric regression notes and we actually did proofs for those things, it would actually be the same. We would still be using this strategy for stuff like splines and wavelets and all the stuff that's defined by optimization problems. So not for kernel estimators, because kernel estimators we usually use like a bias variance decomposition for the risk analysis. But for the things that are defined by optimization problems, like the smoothing spline, the wavelets, the RKHS estimators, all those stuff, we use the same strategy. So we just start with the assertion that the criterion at our solution is less than or equal to the criterion at the, in this case, it would be the underlying regression function. We proceed in this way, and we get something that looks like this, which we would still call the Gaussian complexity term. And in non-parametric problems, typically we bound this via more fancy empirical process theory, like entropy, for example, which we maybe you kind of covered with Larry. Did Larry talk about entropy at all in the conservation? Okay, well, that's, I think, again, it's an advanced technique, but there are other ways to bound this, let's just say, than Holder's inequality. And sometimes we can do better than Holder's inequality, so in different problems, we may choose to do that differently and get different results. So that was just maybe like an editorial comment about how general this strategy is. It really appears throughout a lot of risk analysis for estimators defined by optimization problems. Okay, yeah. Yeah.
You put extra assumptions in?
No. For example, let's ask ourselves these questions. What happened if I told you that these things were each S sparse? What would you do? You probably wouldn't use Holder's inequality. Okay, because Holder's inequality you would just be able to say something about their L1 norm. But what if I actually told you that each of them actually had an L0 norm that was small? And Holder's inequality is kind of loose. Right, because the L1 norm is kind of too big of a measure of complexity. If I told you each of these had small L0 norm, so you'd have to do something more clever, and you could bound this thing, for example, by the supremum over all, let's say, vectors delta that had L0 norm less than or equal to S0 of 2 times W transpose times delta, where this W is X transpose epsilon. Okay, now this thing we can analyze in various ways, but one way to analyze this is to use something about what we call the metric entropy of this set. And we could get a sharper bound than it would just be root log P times the L1 norm. We can get something that's on the order of what we'd expect for subset selection.
My question was more that like you're not bounding WT with anything better.
Oh, so this thing, right. Okay, so where did I write it? This bound, the Gaussian maximal bound, is tight to rate, up to rate. So this actually is a concentration result. The maximum of Gaussians, if they're independent, in the case they're independent, it concentrates around that quantity, the maximum variance times root log p. So we shouldn't expect to do anything better than that. When they're highly correlated, it could be smaller than that. So the sharper ways of bounding this Gaussian complexity don't involve a sharper bound for this quantity. They just never split it up in the first place according to Holder's inequality like that. We would do something else like this. For example, we would try to bound this quantity. And you could think about this in a combinatorial fashion. How many subsets of p things for which there are S0 non-zero entries? There's about p to the S0 of them. For each of those, you could bound this, then you could do like a union bound or something. That would be, for example, a way to do this, to bound this without fancy entropy techniques. And that would already improve on Holder's inequality if I told you that these things were, if each of these were actually L0 sparse to begin with rather than L1 sparse. So I don't have examples like that in the notes, but I'm happy to talk about that, you know, in office hours or something if people are curious. Okay. So we're almost done with what's called the slow rates. I want to say just one thing quickly, then we'll take a break. Slow rates are all of this form for the lasso, root log p over n times some measure of complexity. And they are slower than the rates we'd expect with subset selection, but they're also desirable kind of platform for analysis because we don't assume anything about the correlations between the predictors. So what we talk about a bit after the break is going to be results in which we assume a lot about the correlation structure. And in any given problem, you know, that may be far from being true, but there's nothing really we assumed here except for this column normalization assumption, and that's very innocuous. I mean, you could actually enforce that, right, in any given problem. There's not, that's not really a very strong assumption. Okay, let me very quickly now, just before we break, talk about what happens if we don't assume that the mean is linear. If we don't assume the mean is linear. Because that's kind of an interesting case. And I won't have time to go through the proof because I do want to leave some time for the extra stuff, the more advanced extensions and stuff. But the proof's in the notes, and it's not really much harder than what we already did. The proof's probably the same length as these proofs. So take a look at that if you're curious. In this setting, I think of observing model data from this model, okay, where mu of x is just some underlying function, not assumed to be linear as a function of x. And epsilon is, again, you know, normal 0 sigma squared I. So very similar analysis, where we essentially just introduced a proxy, which is the best linear estimator of this mean function mu of x, provides the following result for the lasso. The in-sample risk, it's actually a pair of results that are kind of proved with the same arguments. The in-sample risk between the lasso and the underlying mean, whatever that happens to be, is less than or equal to the infimum. So look at all. This is the lasso in bound form, by the way. Okay, so this is the lasso solution where the penalty parameter is t in bound form. Okay, so it's less than or equal to the best possible linear estimator of the mean, linear predictor of the mean. It's actually not an estimator because it's not random necessarily. This is like if you gave me the mean function, you told me this is the mean function as a function of x. This is the closest linear approximation I could find that has L1 on less than or equal to t, plus the same kind of bound that we were looking at earlier. Same kind of term, this thing times t. This is true with probability at least 1 minus delta. This is often called the excess risk. This is the risk in excess of the best linear predictor. So if the mean wasn't linear, and we still wanted to understand something about how well the lasso was doing, we'd say that the excess risk, so the difference between these two, is at most, you know, something on the order of root log p over n. That would be one way to think about analysis when we don't have a linear mean function. This is the second result that's proved from these arguments, which I think is actually the even more interesting result of the two. So when the mean's not linear, you could ask two things. You could ask, what is the risk around the mean? In which case, that's going to have to invariably involve something like this, which is called the approximation error. Remember, by the way, this is exactly analogous to what I talked about for non-parametric regression. This is the approximation error. It's how well can this mean function be estimated among members of our class, which are linear functions with L1 norm of the coefficients at most t. And this thing is the estimation error. OK, that's one thing we could look at when we don't assume the mean's linear. The other thing we could look at is actually the distance between the lasso estimator and the best linear predictor of the mean. So let's call beta tilde best to be the guy that minimizes this. Okay, that's well defined because this is the minimum over a compact set, right? This is a compact set, so there's going to be some beta tilde that achieves the minimum. Let's call that such a beta tilde to this guy. And we could ask something like this. How close are these two? Because if the mean's not linear, this is the very best you could hope to do. This is what you're doing in your sample. So how close are you to the best linear predictor of the mean? And the same analysis that produced that actually shows that that's just less than or equal to the second term. Which I think is a very interesting statement, because it means that regardless of how poor a linear approximation is to the mean, the lasso is still going to be very close to the best linear approximation. There is nothing here that involves the approximation error. Right? Nothing on this side involves the approximation error. If I just knew this result, and you wanted this result, and you didn't really look at the way this was proved, and you used the triangle inequality, right? I said that the distance between these two is less than or equal to the distance between this and the mean, and this and the mean, right? Something like that. Then I would essentially get this result, where I multiply this by 2, because maybe I have a second factor of that from the triangle inequality. But that's much, much, much worse than this, because that actually involves how bad a linear approximation is to the mean in the first place, whereas this result doesn't. So a picture of what we've just proved maybe looks like this. I'll just draw a picture real quick. Suppose this is mu of x. Okay, this is mu of x. And suppose this is x beta tilde. Okay, so and this is the distance between the best linear predictor and the actual mean. This could be very, very large. This could be much larger than root log p over n. This can actually even be a constant. Nothing in this analysis precludes that from happening. What we've shown is that still, in any case, the lasso estimator is going to get you very close to x beta tilde best. Right, and this thing is going to be actually on the order of root log p over n. Right, so it's, I think, a pretty interesting conclusion. All right, let's take a break. When we come back, we'll just take a show of hands for who wants to hear what. We have a bunch of stuff we could talk about. Actually, the proofs of all the results are still in the notes. So you can take a look at that if you're interested. And for the fast rates, what I'll mention next, the proof is very similar to the slow rate, except that we do something smarter than this triangle inequality difference between beta hat minus beta 0. And we use the fact that the lasso is sparsely supported, right, if we choose the right lambda, like there's some support set. S involved, and same with, we use the fact that beta 0 is sparsely supported, which is one of our assumptions. Okay, and we do something a little bit smarter than this triangle inequality. And the proof is in the notes. But we still use the same Gaussian maximal inequality. So that's basically how we prove the fast rates. And for this, we assume, same as before, linear model, epsilon normal, x fixed, x column normalized. But this is new. We assume that the support of beta 0, which we call capital S, so the underlying coefficients are sparsely supported, and that's their support. Whereas before, we just assumed that they had, some measure of their L1 norm, right, in the final bounds, which was not the same as actually assuming that they're sparsely supported. We could have had many non-zero coefficients that just were kind of all small. This is a different assumption, assuming that actually it's sparse. And we're going to call its sparsity level the number of non-zero coefficients, little s0. So those are the assumptions to make for the fast rates. And this is the kind of important assumption. I'll write it like this. I'm just going to write it like this. XS transpose XS times 1 over n has lowest eigenvalue on it away from 0. So this is a much, much stronger assumption than anything we've made so far in the slow rates. And this is actually not even what we assume. We actually assume something like a slightly different form than this that's in the notes. There's two different versions of it. Like, they're called the restricted eigenvalue condition and the compatibility condition. They both kind of look like this. And these are the columns of X that are active in the population. So I'm taking out the columns of X that lie in S. That's this matrix XS. And I'm assuming something like the correlations, right? This is the sample covariance matrix of those predictors. So that something like the correlations of the active predictors are not too bad because this thing is not singular. In fact, it's bounded away from being singular. So this, if I look at the sample covariance matrix on the active predictors, the lowest eigenvalue is bounded away from 0. That's like a, sometimes it's called, restricted eigenvalue condition, but I'm leaving out some details that make this more complicated. Okay, so that's what we assume. And then the results get us back into the land of minimax optimality, right, which is that the lasso has in-sample risk that is on the order of S log P over N. Okay? And this is, either true in expectation or with high probability. So that, I'm not going to go through the proof, but that's in the notes. So the conclusion is that if there are not, the correlation structure is not too bad among the active predictors, then the lasso attains the minimax optimal rate that we see in subset selection. And the last thing is support recovery, which I'm not going to cover. That's in the notes as well, which is under this plus other strong assumptions. The lasso is going to actually recover the underlying support exactly with probability going to 1. Okay, so the kind of hierarchy of assumptions are no assumptions essentially for the fast rates, much stronger assumption for the slow rates, no assumption, much stronger assumption for this fast rate. And this one we require even more assumptions that don't appear here. In particular, one of the assumptions we make here is that the smallest non-zero coefficient in beta 0 is big enough. It's bounded away from 0. From the perspective of estimation, that doesn't really matter at all, right? If it was really small but non-zero, then if we missed it, it wouldn't hurt the estimation error. But it would be the case that we might miss it detecting it, right? That here we're saying we have to detect all the right variables in the support of the lasso estimator. So there's a discussion of this in the notes, but you should think of these with skepticism somehow as you proceed through them. That this one is a lot of strong assumptions, and you can pull up simulations where this doesn't happen even in very nice models, that you actually recover the right coefficients. Still, it's an interesting kind of statement that it does happen in kind of some settings. All right, and the proof of this is actually quite different. The proof of this involves the KKT conditions. So if you're interested in seeing a different proof strategy that's not based on the comparison of, you know, of criterions at the solution and at the population, this one is quite different. So that's a kind of overview of theory for the lasso. And now we have like 10 minutes left, and there's a bunch of stuff I could talk about. So let me just do a show of hands. Who wants to hear about alternative procedures for high-dimensional regression and maybe some extensions of the lasso in the last 10 minutes? And who would like to see comparisons of the lasso and subset selection empirically? Okay, that was not nearly clear enough. You guys have to raise your hands higher or just be more definitive. Who wants to hear?
Are those the two options or are there more than options?
Those are the two options for now. We can split the first option into which extensions you want to hear. But who wants to hear some extensions and other estimators? Raise them high. And who'd rather see some like simulations? OK, I'm sorry to those of you who want to see simulations, but I can point you to the paper when we're finished. It's actually nearly finished. Short answer is that subset selection does bad for low SNR and does well in high SNR, which is kind of what you'd expect. But there's a lot more to it than that. It can get quite exotic as the dimensionality of the problem gets high. So now let's see. Who wants to hear about greedy methods, like stepwise regression and stagewise regression, and variants of them? OK. Who wants to hear about relaxations of the lasso, where we try to make them it have less shrinkage? OK. And then the last stuff would be, OK, you know what I'll do? I'll do that, and then I'll pick one myself. I'll do missing data if we have time for that. So let's talk quickly about the relaxed lasso and the adaptive lasso. So one problem the lasso has, which has been documented a lot, is that it tends to shrink the coefficients it tends to shrink the large coefficients, so the coefficients of variables that should obviously be in the model, too much. That's due to its use of the L1 norm, right? So there are various ways to fix that. There's maybe at least three different ways. Those three ways are: do some kind of post-processing after you find a set of variables with the lasso. That's the relaxed lasso. Reweight the L1 norm so that it tends to favor, it tends to penalize things that you think should have large coefficients less. That's the adaptive lasso. And change out the L1 norm entirely for something that is non-convex. Right? The L1 norm looks like this. If we just look at the absolute value of, you know, one component, looks like that. So we're kind of penalizing an equal amount large coefficients to small coefficients. If we change that for something non-convex, like something like this, for example, if that's the penalty function we use on each component, then we would have less shrinkage of the large coefficients, right? Especially if this asymptoted, we may just have a constant penalty for large coefficients. So those are the three different ways, roughly speaking, and there's probably more. They're all in the notes. So let's talk about the relaxed lasso real quick. So the idea is that first you find the active set of the lasso. So I solve the lasso problem at some particular value of lambda. I find its active set. And then I solve another lasso problem. This is a kind of a clever idea, I think. Solve another lasso problem. And this one has two tuning parameters, alpha and lambda. And so we'll call this beta hat relax, where I actually constrain the coefficients to be zero outside of the lasso's active set. So in other words, I solve a reduced lasso problem, where I only allow myself to look at the variables that I saw in the first round of the lasso. And now I decrease the amount of shrinkage I'm putting on the coefficients, or I decrease the price, let's say, of the L1 norm. Right? So if I think of lambda as the price of any coefficient having a unit absolute value, then I make the price alpha times lambda, where alpha is something smaller than 1. So alpha is a parameter that I choose between 0 and 1. Okay, if I set alpha equal to 1, then I get back the lasso solution out of this, right? The relaxed lasso is the lasso. If I set alpha to 0, then what am I doing? So at alpha equals 0, the relaxed lasso is nothing more than doing least squares on the active set. So we get back to stuff like that looks like subset selection. No shrinkage whatsoever. Okay, in most instances, it's the same story as subset selection versus the lasso. You're going to find examples where this does worse than the lasso and where this does better than the lasso. So what you really want to do is consider alpha a separate tuning parameter, and you want to choose alpha and lambda via cross-validation. Okay, you don't really want to just pick one or the other. If you're worried about shrinkage as being an, you know, over shrinkage as being an issue. Okay, something kind of strange happens with the relaxed lasso, which is that as you decrease lambda, you could actually have variables leaving the active set. This is what, from what we know about the lasso paths. So as you decrease lambda, you're decreasing the price of non-zeroness, right? But the lasso path we know is not monotone. So that means that if we make lambda like 0.5 or 0.1, we could actually end up with a relaxed lasso solution that has fewer than you know, however many the size of A as non-zeros. So its support could be a strict subset of A, which is kind of the opposite of what we'd hope for, right? We'd hope for maybe making the non-zero coefficients bigger, and what ends up happening is we can actually end up throwing away one of the non-zero coefficients entirely. So another modification of the relaxed lasso, which I'm a fan of, is just to do something much simpler, which is to interpolate. Let alpha interpolate the least square solution in the lasso solution. This one's also more computationally efficient. So when alpha is 0, we want the lasso. So this would be the definition of an alternative definition for the relaxed lasso. Okay, keep the variables outside of the original lasso active set 0. On the active set, just do a linear interpolation between the least square solution and the lasso solution. Now you won't have that problem I just mentioned. And this guy is also computationally efficient. So there is some theory for this, not quite as much as, I mean, not nearly as much as the lasso or subset selection. But as far as I can tell, this seems to perform fairly well if you were to consider both alpha and lambda as tuning parameters. So it's a nice alternative to the lasso when you're worried about over-shrinkage. Let me just mention what the adaptive lasso is, because that's very related. So the adaptive lasso basically takes a different stance, which is that it says, let's reweight the L1 norm. So in particular, let's suppose you had a good way of guessing which of these coefficients would be large at the solution. Then I would want to make their corresponding weights small, right? Because I wouldn't want to shrink them very much. I would want to make sure that they actually experience less shrinkage. So the adaptive lasso was originally proposed in the low dimensional setting when P was fixed, and when we can just take these to be, so if P is fixed, we can just take wj to be 1 over call it least squares. 1 over the jth component of the least squares solution. All right, this will be an OK estimate of the regression coefficients when p is fixed. I mean, it'll be good when p is very small. If p is kind of comparable, yeah, I mean, in fixed dimensional situations, this will be very good. So this will actually help quite a bit. When p is growing, the adaptive lasso, what would you think you can do for setting the weights? What would be an idea for how you set those weights? You can actually just use the lasso. It's kind of similar to the relaxed lasso. You improve on the lasso solution. So let's say I fit a lasso once. That tells me, it gives me some idea of the sizes of those coefficients. And I use those to reweight the L1 norm when I solve it once more. So that's a very popular strategy as well for improving on the shrinkage in the lasso estimator. Now, we're not going to have time for me to talk about the missing stuff. So I'll just mention now, because it's right in line with this, that non-convex penalties are the third option. And you know, depending on the crowd, maybe the most popular option. So there's a lot of work on non-convex penalties, maybe almost as much as the amount of work on the lasso. And in this setting, we actually think about just replacing the penalty by something of this form. Call that capital P, so you don't confuse it with the number of variables, where this thing is, let's say, it dies off as the absolute value of beta gets large, so that it looks something like this. That p looks something like this function rather than the L1 norm, which means that we don't penalize large coefficients. Now, the usual caveats apply here, which is that we don't know how to solve these problems in general. So the best we can do is to compute local minimizers. But still, the theory kind of has grown to accommodate that. And there's kind of some evidence that this improves quite a bit on the lasso's over shrinkage. But so does the adaptive lasso. And in fact, the most popular, arguably the most popular non-convex penalty is called SCAD. It stands for the smoothly clipped absolute deviation penalty. It looks like this. I didn't draw it great, but it looks kind of like that. And what you can see is that one way people compute SCAD is actually to do something called a local linearization of the penalty. So they make this, they approximate this by a linear function. They solve that so that it looks like a weighted lasso, and they do it over and over again. So the adaptive lasso is actually one step of that local linearization. So if you were to try to solve SCAD, the very first step in the algorithm would be exactly this. Compute the lasso coefficients, reweight the L1 norm, and the adaptive lasso stops at that point and says, pretty good. SCAD would continue. You continue iterating that process. I take the estimates from this weighted lasso, I redefine the weights, and I continue. Okay, so that's the relationship between non-convex penalties and the adaptive lasso. So that's it for high-dimensional regression. Next week, Larry will do graphical models. And then after that, we'll do some advanced topic.